that's not that a blessing will come on your way, only if they persecute you for a rightful cause. Failed to swallow because it understood that this blood is the blood of the C.E.O. of the universe. To be provided, a person who is insecure is the one who desires to be protected. In line with what he has done to them, to those who were in need, he appeared to them as Jehovah Jireh, and then he provided their needs. Greetings to you in the wonderful name of our Lord Jesus. Today is yet another day that the Word of God needs to be ministered unto us. I welcome you all in the mighty name of Jesus. May God bless you. I know this word is just meant for you because you are the ones who are found in this place this day. I say God bless you. Today we'll look at a subject that is entitled The CEO of the Universe. The CEO of the Universe, or the Chief Executive Officer of the Universe. And our reading is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 1. Verses 1. I know it's the first verse in the Bible or in the Old Testament. Genesis chapter 1 verses 1. It's a very common scripture. Even in the Sunday school they do recite it or memorize it. Genesis 1 verses 1. But today, you know, we'll talk about something that's different concerning the same scripture. The Bible recalls from Genesis chapter 1 verses 1, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. Now, for us to understand fully concerning this portion of scripture, the Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The word in, it is a word that talks about the interior of something. So in something, God created the heavens and the earth. I know a lot of theologians and others, they will argue with me, saying that it is the same time that God created the heavens and the earth, of which I strongly disagree, because the Bible is saying that in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. So there was a spiritual heaven that was created way back before the same heaven that is mentioned in Genesis chapter 1 verses 1. So the Bible is saying in something, in, it is a word that talks about the interior of something, in the process, inside the house, in the house, it is where that talks about the something that is interior. So the Bible is saying that God, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. So this symbolizes that God was not in the beginning, God was not in the beginning, but the beginning was in him. So in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. I like saying that this Jehovah is the self, it is the uncreated creator. It is the uncreated creator of the universe, creator of mankind. He was not in the beginning, but the beginning was in him. I wonder, the Bible says that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. He is the uncreated creator of the universe. So he created the heavens and the earth in the beginning. Now the question that we are supposed to ask ourselves is, where were the angels? Because the Bible is saying in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Remember, the Bible says that before the foundation of this world Jesus Christ died, The Bible says, when we look in Job chapter 38, verse 6, we find that the angels were created even before the creation of the earth. The angels were there. So God first created the heavens, and then he followed on to create the earth. The word heaven means above. Even the earth has got a heaven. The heaven. When look above there, that is the heaven. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now we're looking at the topic entitled the CEO of the universe, the chief executive officer of the universe. When talk about this man, this the man on upstairs who is God, he is the CEO of the universe. He is the one who runs the affairs of the universe. So this God, he is indeed the CEO of the universe. The CEO of the universe. I know it is very difficult for us to understand the creation of the world. But Hebrews chapter 11 verses 3, the Bible says, Hebrews 11 verses 3, the CEO of the universe, Hebrews. The Bible talks of that by faith we understand that the world was created by the word of God. Hebrews 11 verses 3. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. In other words, the things that we are seeing were made of the things that are not seen. So the God is the one, the unseen God is the one who created the seen. The things that we see were made of the things that are not seen. The physical things, the things that we can touch, the things that we can feel, the things that we can see, were made of the things that we cannot see, the things that we cannot touch, the things that we cannot feel. That's what the Bible is saying. That by faith we understand that the world was framed by the word of God. So now, if I were to ask somebody, say, can you show me the foundation of this world? Nobody can able to tell us the foundation of this world. So it was framed by the word of God. God is the one who created this same world. What I like calling him, the CEO of the universe. Now the question that we may ask ourselves is, who is a CEO? I know the word CEO, it is a word that is mostly used in business or in companies. This CEO is the chief executive officer. Is a member of the company board of directors. His or her function can be combined with the function of chairman of the board. The CEO is delegated by the board when it is established as a body to have full administrative and representational powers. In the context of this authority, the CEO is in charge of all the company's departments, directs their operation, makes the necessary decision in the framework set out by the applicable legislation. Hallelujah. We're talking about the CEO of the universe. So God was not in the beginning, but the beginning was in him. He is the beginner of the beginning. Is the one who began the beginning, the uncreated creator of the universe. He was not in the beginning, but the beginning was in him. So the one I like saying is the CEO of the universe, is the one who looks after the nine planets in the solar system, the CEO of the universe. Now this same CEO of the universe is a God who is against the subjects that we learn in our in the secondary school or in the education sector. God is against the secondary level school subjects. When we talk about chemistry, we find in John chapter 2 verses 1 going downwards, that is the same God who created, who made wine out of water, of which it is against the principle of chemistry, because in chemistry we are told that for wine to be made there must be some recipes such as grapes and the like. But we find this same man that he made wine just from water. That is an indication that he is the CEO of the universe, is the one who runs the affairs of this world. He doesn't need a method for him to do something, because he does things at his own will. He does things because there is no battle supposed to delegate him. He is the one who does things. He doesn't need to be voted into government, but he has a government that is everlasting. His government is everlasting. The CEO of the universe. To those who are in confusion, he appears to them to be the prince of peace. To those that are in need of counsel, he appears to them as a wonderful counselor. To those that are in need, he appears to them as Jehovah Jireh, the provider. To those who are in need of his protection, he appears to them as a God who protects. He is the CEO of the universe. I'd like just to talk about the subjects that we learn at school. That reminds me, when I was at school, I used to learn chemistry, biology, physics, commerce, geography, science, and mathematics. But I'd like to tell you that this same God is a God that is against the same subject that we learn at school. We find that in mathematics we are told that 1 plus 1, that was in grade 1, I was told that 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, and 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, is equal to 3. But when I was reading the Bible, only to find that the God that I serve is a God who is against the principles of mathematics, but is much interested in mathematics. No wonder he has even included in the Bible the book of Numbers. But here we find that the God that I save is the one who is against the principles of mathematics. We find that 1 plus 1 to him it is 1. 1 plus 1 plus 1 to him it is 1. God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, they are but 1. We find that when 2 get married, but they no longer be two, but 1. That is the God who is against the principle of mathematics. We find also in commerce, we are told that for you to buy something, you really need to have money, which is the medium of exchange. The medium of exchange. So for me to obtain something, I really need to have money in order for me to get it. But in Isaiah 55 verses 1, I'm told by God, he says, come to me, Isaiah. Isaiah 55 verses 1 is against the principle of commerce. Isaiah 55 verses 1, the Bible records, everyone that is thirsty, come ye to the waters, and he that have no money, come ye buy and eat. Ye come buy milk and wine without money and without price. So is the one who is against the principle of commerce, because I cannot just enter into the shop and then I begin to buy things without money, because money is the medium of exchange. But here we find that God is telling us that come, even if you don't have money, you'll be able to buy wine and milk. You'll be able to buy something. Even if you don't have money, you'll be able to buy something. I tell you, my brothers and sisters, from this portion of scripture, I understand that if I have Jesus, I have everything. I can do anything. I can have everything, because he's everything in my life. He is the CEO of the universe. He is able to learn the affairs of this world. you be able to learn the affairs of my life. He is the CEO of the universe. And in biology, we are told that for a child to be there, or for a woman to conceive, there must be a participation of a man. But here we find God in Matthew chapter 1, verses 23, is against that same principle. 23, verses 18, we find that it's let us read the Bible so that we can understand very well what God was talking about concerning the same. It's against the principle of biology, even if is much interested into the same, the CEO of the universe. God against biology. CEO of the universe. Matthew chapter 1 verses 23. The Bible records, behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had binded him, and took him his wife. He knew her not until she brought forth our first son, and he called his name Jesus. We find that Mary was found pregnant without the participation of any man. It is the God who is against the principle of biology. The CEO of the universe is the God who does things in his own way, in his own style, in his own method. The CEO of the universe. We find that there is also a principle in geography that says that the earth rotates around the sun. But in Joshua chapter 10 verses 12 going downwards, we find a story about Joshua, that Joshua spoke to the sun. He says, sun, stand still. And then in geography, we are told that the earth is the one that rotates around the sun. I'm a little bit confused, because here Joshua spoke to the sun instead of speaking to the earth that earth stand still, but spoke to the sun. He says, sun, stand he still. Stand still. Joshua chapter 10 verses 12. The Bible records that then spoke Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, sun, stand thou still upon Gideon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Joshua? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven, and has not gone down about a whole day. Joshua spoke to the sun. He says, sun, stand still. But in geography, we are told that the sun, the earth is the one that rotates around the sun. This is so confusing. A God, the CEO, is the one that is against the principle of geography. The sun, stand still. Joshua spoke to the sun. He never spoke to the earth. So that simply means God was against the principle of geography. God is against the principle of geography. When we talk about science, we find we are told that the man was a man evolved. He came from an ape or from a monkey. But here the Bible says in Genesis that God created man. Man does not revolve. Man was created by God. So God is against the principles of science. Let us read the Bible, Genesis chapter 1, verses 26, the Bible records, and God said, let us make man in our own image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish, over the sun, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created to he him, male and female created he them. And God blessed them and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply they blemish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. So we are told that God said, let us make man in our own image, in our own likeness. So man never revolved. Man was created by God. So God is against the principle of science, which is evolution. Evolution is a study that talks about the origin of man. I think the one who is in charge is Charles Darwin, is the one that is in charge, is the one that brought in that same philosophy. But God is against the same principle, because man was created by God in his own image and likeness. So God against the principle of science. We find in physics, they say an heavy load cannot float on water, but here comes Jesus. The Bible clearly indicates that he walked on water. He walked on water. He was not drowned, but he walked on top of the water. The CEO of the universe is the one who runs the affairs of this world. He is not oppressed by the principles that runs through nature, but is the one who controls the laws of nature. He is the CEO of the universe. The CEO of the universe. God against the subjects that we learn at school. God against the knowledge of this world, because the Bible says that the wisdom of this world is foolishness unto him. Is foolishness unto him. So the God that we save is against the principles of the subjects that we learn at school. Because he is the one that is in charge of the loose laws that governs the earth. The loose laws that governs the earth. The CEO of the universe is the one who looks after the affairs of this world. So if he can look after the affairs of this world, is able to look after the affairs of your business, is able to look after the affairs of your family, is able to look after the affairs of your business, is able to look after the affairs of your life, because he is the CEO of the universe. No wonder when he died, he had to raise from the dead, because he is the CEO of the universe. He cannot be obliged by the rules and laws that governs nature, but is the one who is in charge of the rules and laws that governs the earth. I know when we talk about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, because they understood that the God that they serve, he is the CEO of the universe. So when they brought them up, when they brought them before the king, because they were bowing down to an image, they started comparing an image with the God that they serve. They said, we cannot bow down to this image, because the God that we serve is the one who governs the affairs of this world. We won't bow down. Whether he delivers us or not, he is our deliverer. Whether he delivers us or not, we won't be able to bow down and worship your image. And then they were thrown into the blast furnace. The Bible says the CEO of the universe appeared in the blast furnace. He appeared to save them. He appeared to save them because he is the CEO of the universe. And then he has promised that you shall pass through the waters and the waters won't destroy you. You shall pass through the fires and the fire won't burn you. So they understood that same portion of scripture. That's why they were not even got burnt, because the God that they save, he is the CEO of the universe. He is the CEO of the universe. There have never been any man who came back from the dead, but Jesus came back from the dead to show us that he is the one who runs the affairs of the universe, is the one who runs the affairs of this world. Even the earth refused to keep him longer, nor erased from the dead. The earth refused to swallow the blood that was dropped on it. It failed to swallow because it understood that this blood is the blood of the CEO of the universe. The CEO of the universe. He is the one who runs the affairs of this world. When you begin to understand that the God that you serve is the CEO of the universe, you begin to see yourself the way God sees you. You begin to see the God that you are under. You begin to see the government that you are under. You begin to see the company that you work from, the company that you are under, the boss that you are under. He is the CEO of the universe. He's the one who learns after the affairs of this world. Is the one who learns after the affairs of this world. No wonder even the people in the old days, they have failed even to give him a name. Others they call him Elion, others they call him Yahweh, others they call him Jehovah, others they call him Jehovah Jireh, others they call him Jehovah Shammah, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Shalom, El Shaddai, and the like. A lot they have failed to give him just one name, because he is the CEO of the universe. He is a man, a God that we cannot fully understand. But the only way we can understand him, it is through his whole word and through his deeds in our lives. Because the things that we see around are the indication that indeed he is a mighty God. When we look at the way the earth has been framed, we'll be able to understand that indeed he is a greatest designer. He is the CEO of the universe. The CEO of the universe. To those who have done medicine, to them he is the physician, the greatest physician. To those that are in need, he is indeed the greatest provider. He is the CEO of the universe. The CEO of the universe. I was trying to figure it out, why he has a lot of names in the Bible. And then one thing that I understood was God was appearing to, when he appears to somebody, and then he shows them his mighty power. They used to call him in line with what he has done to them. To those who were in it, he appeared to them as Jehovah Jireh, and then he provided their needs. No wonder they called him to say he is Jehovah Jireh. But that does not mean he's just Jehovah Jireh. But to some who were in confusion, he appeared to them to be Jehovah Shalom, the God of peace. But that does not mean that he's just Jehovah, the God of peace. To those who were sick, he appeared to them to be Jehovah Rapha, the God that heals. So people used to name God according to the way he provided their needs. He intervened to their needs in their to their situation. The way he responded to their situation. He is the CEO of the universe. The CEO of the universe. I know others, they call him Elion, which means the creator. To those who understand that the God is the one who created the heavens and the earth, they call him Elion. And then to those who understand that he is indeed the Most High, is the one who is elevated, they call him Elion, the God Most High. To those who understand that there is nothing that is hidden in his sight, everything is naked unto him. They like calling him Eloi, which means the God who sees. And then from there we can see in Genesis 16 verses 13 to 14 we find that they called him at Eloi, God who sees. To those who understand that there is no power who is mighty than him, to those who have seen his mighty work, the way he saved the children of Israel, the way he saved a lot of people in the old days, to them they call him El Shaddai, the God Almighty. To those who have seen his mighty, they call him Jehovah El Shaddai. To those who want to know him very well, to know him as Lord, they call him Adonai, the Lord, my Lord. Those